Ladies and gentlemen, David Duquette with the clicker. I hope.
There we go. First of all, I want to thank everyone in the room for having me here. I've never been to Asia, never been to Vietnam, and I'm amazed at the people here, the greeting, the hospitality, and I'll be back for sure. And the product that I'm going to talk about today is very basic to golf. It's the grass, right? And a lot of times in these conferences, they leave that part out, is you play golf on grass. And so in my mind, that's one of the most important products that you can have and talk about. Well, in my history, I've been in the grass business for 45 years, and I did all the same things everyone else did. And then I decided that it was time to start developing my own varieties. Usually you get a variety from a university system and you wait 10, 20 years to get a variety. And I was I didn't have the patience for that. So I decided that we were gonna start our own breeding program at Bladerunner in Texas. And that, no one else was doing it. I'm probably the only one at the size of research that we do on warm season grasses. I guess I'll read this for you right quick. Bladerunner Farms is the world's largest privately owned zoysia grass research and development facility. Family owned business, my wife and I run it. We develop grasses that are licensed to quality sod farms all over the world. I'm gonna tell you who they are here in a few minutes. And the facility grows sod for sales in Poteet. The grasses developed by Bladerunner Farms are some of the most advanced, environmentally friendly, drought-tolerant grasses available on the market today. And if you're dealing with water restrictions, salt, drought, shade, extreme weather, we can help you create a beautiful, healthy lawn, turf facility with grasses on the cutting edge. That's our whole goal, is to bring you varieties that will do what you need it to do to get a quality surface, but at low cost. Our whole idea is to, I believe that if golf doesn't change, that if the maintenance on a golf course doesn't change, these $2 million budgets are over for most golf courses. Not for everyone, but for most golf courses. So what we're trying to do is produce grasses that will give you a quality surface without all the inputs, without all the cost involved. And we believe we can cut your maintenance budget in half. And we're doing that in most places. I don't know a lot about Asia yet, but I'm going to learn more. And we have a very large research development center at our farm. We have thousands of varieties that we go through. It's not one, it's not two, it's not one that somebody found at a university and starts promoting the hell out of it, and then you start using it. We go through thousands of varieties to pick the one grass that we believe will work. And I've been doing this for 25 years, research and development, and we've only released three grasses. So it takes a long, long time to develop these grasses, but we believe that it's worth it. So we go through thousands and thousands of varieties to pick the grass that we believe will work for you. We have a private breeding program in Texas, but we also have a breeding program, a partnership with the University of Georgia. That's Dr. Brian Swartz on the screen and one of my sons. When I said 10,000 at the farm, he's probably gone through 50,000 in the greenhouses and test plots at the University of Georgia. So we have many, many, many varieties that we go through to try to find the best one. This program hasn't released the grass yet. It's been in effect for 8 years. I think in the next couple of years we will see a grass come out of this program. Y'all think y'all have cheap labor here. That's my labor. That's my grandkids. I just thought I'd throw this in here. Every time we pick a variety, we blow it up in a greenhouse, and then we plant it in a, what's called a foundation field. Now, that foundation field is really important because it provides the plant material for everywhere we go. The foundation field is in Texas. If we want to put a field in Vietnam, all the plant material comes from Texas to Vietnam. So we try to keep quality assurance. Every planting comes from that foundation field. Then it comes here. Then we set up a field here, which if you come this afternoon, there's a field day this afternoon at one of the sites. And we walk those fields. We send inspectors to those fields two or three times a year. And we try to make sure that when you order a variety of grass from us or our licensed growers, you get that grass. Here's our growers in Asia. Our international licensing rights are Team Zoysia International. That's Dr. Milt Engelke. He's right over here. He'll be on the panel in a little bit. In our Zeon Zoysia grower is Sports Turf Solution, Brad Burgess. He's right over there. He's going to be on the panel. And then we have Stellar Zoysia grass is with Sky 72, maybe Team Zoysia Asia. So they're in South Korea. So. Right now, we have two growers. We don't want a lot of growers. We're trying to keep the grasses clean. We're trying to make sure you get the right variety when you ask for it. And so we're just going to have very few growers here in Asia. But we believe the grower network is better than maybe some of the networks you've been having to go through so far. From what I understand, you're buying from a broker in most instances, and the grasses are coming from the States. Well, that's okay, but with our program, you're getting it from the source. We develop it, we use foundation fields, we bring it here, we send inspectors. So we're trying to keep these fields perfect for you guys here in Asia. The grass that's here now is called Zeon Zoysia. Again, you'll see that this afternoon at the field day. This is the mainstay of our golf program. You'll see in a minute, it's on a lot of courses in the States and around the world, and this has been our number one Zoysia seller for golf. And Brad Burgess over there, Sports Turf Solution has it here. There's some projects already going on. They look fantastic. I was on some of these projects in the last few days, and they look spectacular. I don't know if you know this or not, but Zoysias were native to Asia. That's where they come from. And so, a long time ago, some people from the States came here, collected, Dr. Engelke was one of them, and they collected the grasses from here in Asia, brought them back to Texas into Beltsville, Maryland, and then over the time, I got involved and bought one of the collections, and from that, we get our grasses now. So originally, they came from Asia, we're bringing them back, hopefully in a better farm. People don't realize what's under the surface, okay? And so I just washed this for you. Under Bermuda grass, paspalum, there are roots and there are rhizomes in some instances, but these zoysias are tremendous rhizome producers. Lots of rhizomes, lots of roots, and that's what you want for health, for drought, for all the different reasons zoysias are important. So I just washed that for you so you can see what it looked like underneath. L1F is another zoysia that'll be coming here soon. We use it a lot. It's a finer texture than Zeon. It actually will go on greens, tee to green, tees, fairways, and greens. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But that's another grass that's coming here very soon. And we're using a lot for tee boxes, for green surrounds, and greens. And that's the underneath of L1F. It's quite surprising that this is finer texture than the Zeon, more rhizomes, more roots than even the Zeon, more growing points. And that's important for divot recovery. A lot of people believe that zoysias are slow. Okay, they're slow to recover. The divots won't repair. Well, that's not true at all. They have so many growing points under the surface that they'll come back very, very fast from divot problems. This is a greenhouse with Sky 72 in South Korea. They're blowing up their foundation material of Stellar Zoysia. And that's an approach. They have several golf courses there in the Seoul area, and they're starting to use it on their own golf courses to see how things are going, and then it'll be moved out into the general use. So that's in South Korea. Stop it. All right, projects. Show you a few projects like the other fellows have. This is a Trinity Forest. It's in Dallas, Texas. The designers are Coor Crenshaw. I think y'all would know that name. Ben Crenshaw is a friend of mine. They use our grass a lot on their projects. And this course is very unique for Texas. No trees. It was an old garbage dump that they refurbished and brought back. And the tournament, the Byron Nelson tournament, will be moved there this year. And they've had a lot of tournaments up to now, and everyone's very happy with what's going on here. This particular project is all L1F zoysia, the entire acreage except for the greens. So our first L1F project in the States. It's done tremendous, and we're very happy with this one. This is another course we did with Tiger Woods. This is Blue Jack National in Houston. Tiger's the designer. L1F tees and green surrounds and aprons, Xeon fairways. I don't know if you guys see the striping, the zoysia stripe a lot. I hope you ask some questions later if I forget things, but very easy to stripe. We were on some projects the other day in Cameron. You guys in here? Anyway, it stripes very nice. Very, very nice surface. Tiger liked these surfaces so much, we're using them in his next project in Missouri, we're also on. And then he's got a project in the Bahamas and called Jack's Bay, and we're also doing that one. So every project that Tiger's done in the States so far, we've been involved in. This is the project when you asked earlier about what project are you most proud of. And this is it. This is the Olympic golf course in Brazil. I messed up that Parsons yesterday. I think instead of the Christ, we should have had that girl, right? The girl that he had on his video. But this was an ad we did for golf in the Olympics and the Xeon Zoysia. And it turned out really good, and we were proud to be involved in this project. Yeah, you're doing it for me? Okay. This is the site. When I first went down there, when we first got awarded the project for the grass, I've never been to Rio, so I get down there, and this is another trash dump. That's what it was. It was an old sand pit, and then over 50 years, they just dumped trash there. So we got there, and that's my grower in Brazil, Marcelo Mata. Gil Hance is in the background. He was the architect. And we were walking the course. PGA Tour guy was on the left, so walking the course for the first time and wondering what we had gotten ourselves into. I just showed this you guys, when you're first working with these zoysias, this is a very good thing to do. The superintendent decided he didn't know anything about zoysia. He was a paspalum guy. He didn't know zoysia, so we gave him a whole group of pots, and then he used different fertility rates with the soils that were on site to see what worked for him. And it really worked out well. When it was time to plant the grass, he knew what to use. He knew all the fertility he wanted to do. He knew the soils all over the course. So very, very good. I would recommend this to anybody. When you're first working with these zoysias, get you some test sites going and learn how to manage them and grow them before you get them. I thought this was a great idea. We were involved in it, and it was nice. This is the site. Once it was cleared, now again, I don't know how much you know about this, but that site was cleared by hand in the beginning. Gil Hance got there. There were a lot of problems with the site ownership. They were in lawsuits over the ownership of the land. So for 6 months, he had a crew with machetes and chainsaws clearing the property. They had a bulldozer that was about 100 years old. And that's what they did for the first few months when they got there. He had nothing when we got to the site. But this is the site when it was cleared. That's the ocean there and Rio in the background. It keeps jumping. I hold it too long. Neil Cleverly was the superintendent. And what's interesting about this picture, we laid this for a promotion. The mayor and the Olympic committee wanted to promote the golf course, so they laid this. I went home for 2 weeks. When I came back, we pulled it up, and that's two and a half weeks of growth. That's all it is. The root system is extensive on these things. I think we have a picture later we'll show you again about the root system. But that was the first load we ever laid on the Olympic golf course. I don't know, a lot of you may not know, where sprigs come from, so I put this in. This was the farm in Rio where we harvested the sprigs. Harvested sprigs, put them in the hopper, then they came to the city. The one thing about Rio, it's not, not It's worse than here. If you've been out in the traffic, you can't move through the city. Our farm was on the opposite side of the city, so we had to harvest and bring everything in during the night. You couldn't get through the traffic. So every delivery was made during the night and gotten there at 7. So that's the way we harvest sprigs. This is the way we planted the sprigs. Do you do it by hand here? It's done by hand? Anyway, we have machines that do this sprigging. So that was the sprigs going down on the course. Now, one thing that the PGA Tour and the RNA, they were worried about sprigging the golf course. They didn't think we could get it ready in time. And we've had a lot of experience at doing this, so we told them, yes, we'll get it ready. Everyone thought, if you were watching the news, there was no one saying the golf course would be ready on time. Everyone was thinking it would never be ready, and we were sitting on site saying, yeah, it will. We're going to make it get ready. So we modified the equipment. I can see there's a lot of tires on there. It was very, very sandy. So we modified all the equipment to make it work on the site, and it went perfectly. Once we put in the sprigs, then we coulted it in. Some people top dress over the sprigs, but we coulted. And it worked very, very well. And that's the finished product. That was the course once it was grown in. And again, we had lots of opposition. Everything going wrong. Everyone saying it wasn't going to get ready. And we were ready a year ahead. A year in advance, we were ready. It could have been played. I just thought I'd throw in who won. Justin Rose won for England. We got any England? Anybody from England? And watch this one. Who won the women? Come on. NB Park. NB Park won the gold. So from Asia. So I was there. It was a very nice experience and a wonderful experience for me and my wife. I just threw this in because I don't know if any of you also work with sports fields, but we're also moving into the sports field arena. We've got several projects that are going on. This is the Texas Rangers field. We've done some work with the Astros. We're doing some work with the Miami Dolphins and starting to get the Zoises into sports fields. So I just threw this in to let you know it's not just for golf. Sports fields, landscape, it'll be fine. Just to give you some idea, the first grass here is Xeon, and that's fine, but in all our research, we're always looking for better color, better textures, less puffiness. I see a lot of common Zoysia here with a lot of puffiness in it. We're taking that puffiness out. You won't have to deal with that when you're working with our grasses, okay? And this is the color we're getting. One of the things we're trying to do, again, is cut the maintenance out. So with this grass on the bottom, why fertilize? That's natural color. So in the future, we'll be able to give you a grass that you won't have to mow as much, water as much, pesticides, and now you're not going to have to fertilize because we're going to give you that color, okay? Also, one of the other issues in Zoysia that you hear about is disease. Now, on the courses that I've been on here in Vietnam and in Thailand, I've seen no disease. I don't know why that is, because you're tropical, you've got humidity, you've got rainfall. All grasses get some disease. But in this case, this was in North Carolina. On top is a Bermuda grass full of disease. On the bottom is Xeon with nothing, okay? No disease. So yes, we do get it in certain circumstances, but I think it's minimal here. I haven't seen any. I think my grower here hasn't seen any disease in 2 years, in a couple of years. So disease may not be a big issue here, which we worry about in other parts of the world, but it's not showing up here. Shade is another thing that everyone talks about, not so much on your new courses that you're building, but on older courses. As the trees get tall, Bermuda grass and paspalum don't have near the shade tolerance of Zoysia grass. So I was showing you this one. This is a Blue Jack again, Tigers course. That building at 10 o'clock in the morning goes to shade, and the shade's there for the rest of the day. And that's been there for 3 years. And I see no difference between the shaded area and the sunny area. So shade, I think we've got really, really, really good shade tolerance. There it is under shade trees, and the same thing. This is another golf course. This is a course that's 17 years old. This is a Tom Fazio course in San Antonio, Texas. 17 years under that shade and still there. So to me, we can do the science, which we have, and we know it's shade tolerant from our university research, but that's what I look at. 17 years under heavy shade and still there. a mowing study at our farm. What we did, USGA, PGA, they were all worried about how fast we could grow these grasses in. And so at our farm, we made a machine that would punch one hole every 6 inches, and we put one sprig in that hole. Now, they tell me that's 20 or 30 bushels to the acre at that rate, but every sprig lived because we put it by hand into the hole. And so that was at about a month, and some of them were much faster than others, but over a 3-month period, almost all of them filled in. Some of them took 4 months. But when you hear zoysia is slow from sprig production, I'm not saying it's as fast as paspalum and Bermuda in the beginning, but I believe you get a quality playing surface quicker with zoysia than you do with the other grasses. It may not cover the ground as quickly at first, but I believe you get to the quality surface quicker. So that would be my comment on that. Some of you have seen these things, some of you hadn't. This is coarse texture. This would be similar to the common types you have here. This is medium texture. I think you also have some of these grasses, native to the area, but the difference is that we're going through these things for thatch buildup, for growth, for water, all those different things. We go through them. We might have 500 of these that we're looking at, and we pick one, okay? And this is the fine texture. What we'll talk about in a little bit is going tea to green with these fine textured zoysias, where you'll have one grass tea to green. This was a booth we set up. No one in the southeast of the United States had seen these zoysias for green, so this is a booth we set up. 5 minutes? I better hurry. Okay. This is a booth we set up to show tea to green and why mow, okay? On these fine textured zoysias, we have what we call low riders right now, and we're getting a quality surface mowing them once a week. Now, I know that sounds, you won't believe it, but these are new varieties that we've got that we're getting a quality playing surface mowing once a week. So if you're mowing 3 or 4 times a week, we're going to drop it down to once a week in the future. This is greens, fairways, and tees. Just change the mowing height, one grass. Yeah, one grass, okay? Yeah, that's coming. It's not here yet. That's not Xeon, that's not L1F. These are new ones. I wanted to show you a little bit of the future, okay? This last part will be the future. This is Blue Jack National again, tee to green. One grass on the tee, fairways, and rough. The greens are stimping 11 and a half. I don't think you need any faster than that, but in the future we'll have greens that'll even be faster. But this is Tiger's course in Houston, tee to green, one variety. And there's my why mow. This is the Olympics again, the Olympic golf course. But we're going to take away all that mowing. You're not going to have to mow as often. You're not going to have to repair your equipment as often. You're not going to have to buy as much equipment. We're going to solve that for you. I'll hurry because this is Tennessee, this University of Tennessee, doing research on our varieties for greens. That's the plots at Tennessee. There they go. This is also, they're the varieties that we're working on for greens. L1F, M60, M85, and 1308. Every one of them will stimp 11 and higher. The M85 and M60, we've had them at 14 with not much problems at all. I don't know that we need that, but if you've got a championship course and want that kind of speed, we're going to give it to you. That's a mini Verity Bermuda green and an L1F zoysia. Watch when I take it up close. The Bermuda on the left, mini Verity. L1F zoysia on the right. There's no comparison in the density, none at all. And then we have shade issues on greens. We're going to get, you're not going to have that problem anymore. L1F can take the shade. Another set of plots. I'm going to hurry. This one's really important. This is the TPC Sawgrass. This is PGA Tour. This is their agronomist. Every one of those guys there are with the PGA Tour, and they're looking at all our zoysias for greens. And for the tea to green, okay? So that we gave them a presentation. They didn't believe us. We said, okay, you put in a plot. So they put in a 2-acre site there at TPC Sawgrass. We're going through all the evaluations now. We've already done 2 courses for them, TPCs. The first one was in Sugarloaf in Atlanta. More are coming. Just another picture of their work on the greens. And hey, I got it done. Look at this. I'm on my last thing. Again, our licensing team is Sports Turf Solutions, Team Zoysia Asia, which is also Sky 72. And I'm done. Thank you.
David, absolutely fabulous. Very exciting stuff. Now tell me, most people will ask, do you prefer genetically modified because it might be quicker, or are you one of those natural guys?
I believe Mother Nature does the better job. If it lasts in Mother Nature, we watch these plots for 10 and 15, 20 years.
Hold on just a second. Did I hear that right? You watch these plots for 10, 15, or 20 years before you go commercial with this?
Before we go commercial. Yeah, it takes that long. So, yes, I think Mother Nature does. All of ours that we have right now are not. Right. But we are working with the University of Georgia where they do that kind of work.
So as you look at the future of grasses, if there was only one thing you're trying to modify your grasses to address, what is the one most important something that needs to be addressed in the future?
Well, if we were in the, it depends on where you are, okay? So if we're in a dry climate, it would be water use. Mm-hmm. And we're very good on less water use here. It rains all the time, I guess. Mm-hmm. It rained while I've been here. Mm-hmm. But I think turf quality, you know, the playability of the surface and doing it at half the cost. Mm-hmm. That's the big thing. We're going to give you a quality playing surface at half the cost.
How will you get the half the cost? What do you mean by that?
Less mowing, less fertilizing, less chemicals. I mean, I don't think anybody here has put an insecticide on their zoysia yet. I don't think anyone's put a fungicide on it. I hear some of these other products, they're having to put fungicides out. They're having to use pesticides. We haven't used any. Mm-hmm. And then we're going to do these new ones, and you're not going to mow once a week.
You're responding, I assume, to the regulatory environment as well.
Yes.
How is the regulatory environment for grasses and their maintenance? What's happening there?
Well, you know, I'll use the states because that's what I know. In the states, Arizona, California, they no longer have fairways. They got to get rid of the fairways, right? They have tee boxes, they have some small fairway areas, they have the greens. They've had to get away 20, 30, 40 acres because of water. And that you're going to see that more and more in drier climates. Right. I don't know if that'll happen here, but water's a big issue.
So as I look at these grasses, a lot of clubs, at least in the states, have to use reconstituted water, reused water.
Mm-hmm.
High salt content can really be a bear on grasses. How do you address something like that?
The zoysias are very good. They're very drought tolerant, and they also take. We actually have a farm. We're using effluent water on the farm.
Okay.
Yeah. So we I don't think there's going to be a problem one with, you know, poor water quality.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Grass right here. Give him a hand, David Duquette.
Thank you.